I achieve anything in life, I close my eyes and try to remember everyone who encouraged me. And eventually, after I shut my eyelids down, I see a face. I see a face of a woman from a village of Nepal with teary eyes, carrying two children by her side, asking me, "What about me? Will I have a worth in this society, or shall I always remain a dependent and a baby producer of a family? Will I ever be able to establish my own identity, or shall I always remain an economically inactive, a second-class citizen of the country?" And this awakens me. And then I realize that I just don't carry myself, but I also carry the future of all the teen girls who are banished for bleeding. I carry responsibilities of all the children who look at me and wonder if they could speak English like I do. I carry dreams of all the females who doesn't even know how to hold a pen and rely on a thumbprint for a signature. Nepal is a beautiful country with more than 120 different cultures. And with this diversity comes superstition. And the thing which hurts me the most is almost all the superstition are against females. Chaupari. Chaupari is a custom where females are banished for bleeding. They are compelled to live in a hut, which is normally a livestock shed or a courtyard outside the house. And they are considered to be impure and are considered to bring bad luck to the society, so they are not allowed to touch any men. They are not allowed to go inside the kitchen or any households, but they are made working horses outside. As the hut where they live, which is known as chow shed, is not safe. They don't have a proper doors and windows, and the consequences is severe. There are cases where females die because of animal attack or snake bites or sometimes severe cold or rapes. And still the society does not change. 21% of the total household in Nepal still practice chaupari. And if we talk about just the western side, the midwestern and the western side of Nepal, 90% of the household practice chaupari. Now talking about the southern part of Nepal, dowry system is a culture which has a deep root. And this custom is generally practiced during wedding, where a groom's family, he asks for money and property to the bride's family. And the amount of property depends on how much money did the family invested on his living, on his education, and how wealthy the family are. And if they're not satisfied with the amount of property they get, then they start threatening the females emotionally, physically, verbally, psychologically. There are cases where females are burnt alive, thrown acid at, are beaten up brutally, and sometimes are compelled to commit suicide. There is not a proper statistics for what percentage of people are actually following dowry, because the one who follow just follow it as a culture, not as a punishable act. And because of this, people do not want a female child in their family. It is considered that having a female child will not open up a doors of heaven for them after their death. They believe males, if they have a male child, they will go to heaven or else not. And they keep on producing daughters unless they have a son. And what happens to the daughters after they are born? They just work around their mother, learn all the household activities, and once they are around their teens, they're ready for wedding. 37% of the females, they get married before the age of 18, whereas 10% of the females, they get married before the age of 15, though the legal age of marriage is 20 in Nepal. And what happens after she has gotten married at that young age? The legacy continues. She will not have that enough courage and knowledge to speak against the society and against the so-called first-class citizen of the country. And the legacy continues. So These superstitions tail up to a lot of social problems. Me, my father, my grandfather would often have this conversation about how could we eradicate superstition from the society. And my grandfather, he often gives me his example, saying that he was a sixth child of his parents, and all the fifth child were daughters. They were not allowed to go to schools, but he, luckily, was allowed to do whatever he wanted, so he chose to go to school. He became a teacher, and then he never allowed my mother to follow superstition. And for me, all this superstition was just a story unless I went to the villages and saw the brutal conditions of females there. My father, he opened an organization called Kashinath Memorial Foundation on my grandfather's name, which gives scholarship to the female for their higher education. But me, being a third generation to my grandfather, I have a broader plan. I have a more scientific plan. I came down with three major aspects which if we work on that, we would get rid of superstition. And those three points are A, illiteracy. More than 50% of the total population of Nepal are females, and only 53% of the females are literate, whereas the rest doesn't even know how to read and write. And that's why the females do not even know that all the cultures they are practicing as a ritual are actually punishable acts. B, poverty. 25% of the total population of Nepal live a life below the poverty line, earning 50 cents USD per day. And C, skilled manpowers. Nepal is an underdeveloped country and it needs a lot of skilled manpower for the whole country to develop. And the only one way I came up with which could look up to all these three aspects is vocational training. Vocational training is a technical education given to students by which they could get a specific knowledge on either trade, craft, or as a technician. This could give them a certificate and give them a qualification of a job. Education is free in Nepal till 10th grade, but still people are not inclined to go to school. Why? Because parents think, what after school? Because they will not have any job after their 10th grade. So they believe that let's make that child work for us so that they could financially support us rather than sending them to school. That's why 40% of the children are involved in child labor in Nepal. So vocational training, I believe we should implement so that it could actually drag people into education and actually give them a job, which could eventually eradicate illiteracy as well as poverty from the country, and country would get the skilled manpower which it needs to develop the country. We live in a sophisticated world where we all think bigger and better. We all want female presidents, female prime minister, more female leaders. But we sometimes tend to forget that in some nations, women actually need a pat at the back, and they need the assurance which could tell them that you have a voice and it's strong. You have a voice which could change your world. I hope one day the world could be as prosperous, Nepal could be as prosperous as never before, and I could peacefully close my eyes and see all happy faces around. Thank you. Namaste.